I'm back few slides back today. The reason is that I just want to remind ourselves about the most important part, simple, but we have to remember them again, that in our electrical power systems, large, high voltage, high power, high current power system, we use protective relays to detect any kind of fault. And once the fault is detected, we use circuit breakers to clear the fault, meaning isolating the parts that are faulty and keeping the parts that are healthy intact. So the parts that are healthy, it has to be kept intact in the system. The parts that are faulty has to be isolated. So that's what we do using the protective relay and the circuit breaker for power systems engineer, protection engineer, or electrical engineer. When we deal with protection, our task is to know the prospective short circuit currents in each and every part of the power system so that we can design the power system protection or the protection schemes for that part of the system and as a whole for the whole power system. And we cannot leave any part of the power system unprotected. And we also need those short circuit currents to design the specification for the circuit breaker that will be utilized to interrupt the circuit of the fault during the fault conditions. Then we come to fault calculations, where we have a lot of variables, parameters that we need to deal with when we try to calculate the fault currents, fault MVAs, megavolt ampere. Then we express them in power units or percentages. Normally it comes with percentage, but if we express them in power units, it makes our calculation easier. Now, percentage is a quantity that we know. For example, I can see there are 15 of you are present in this class, and we have a class of, let's say, 69 students in this power system. So out of 69, we have 15 people present. So we know what is the percentage of attendance today. So it's 15 over 69 times 100. You can calculate it, and we use percentage quantities in our real life all the time, and it makes our understanding easy if we talk about percentage and so on. But in power system fault calculation, if we use another term or terminology, power unit, it makes our calculation even easier. So let's try to understand what that power unit is. And to understand that, let me consider this expression here, that I have a transformer which has two sides, high voltage and low voltage side. High voltage side is rated as 6.6 kV and the low voltage side is rated as 380 volts. So 6.6 kV, 380 volts. So 6600 on the high voltage side and 380 volt on the low voltage side. So if we apply 6600 volt on the high voltage side, we will get 380 volt on the low voltage side. Now I'm considering a case that I have applied 6000 volt on the high voltage side instead of 6600 volt. So how much of the voltage that we get on the low voltage side, we can calculate easily. If we applied 6600 volt, we'll get 380. Now we applying 6000 volt, so we'll get 345.45 volt on the low voltage side. Now, interestingly, what we are going to discover now is that these 6000 volt that was applied to this high voltage side is how much percentage, in terms of percentage, it is how much 6000 volt corresponding to 6600 volt is how much, how many percentage? Can you calculate and tell me what's the percentage if we applied 6000 volt to that high voltage side, which is rated at 6600, what is the percentage? Calculate and tell me quickly. Yes, 90.9%. So actually what we did when we applied 6,000 volt, instead of 6,600 volt, we applied 90.9% of the rated volt. We applied 90.9% of the rated volt. And because of that, we got 345.45 volt on the low voltage side. Now that 345.45 volt is also a percentage of at 380 volt. Can you calculate that one? 345.45 is how many percentage of 380 volt that is the rated voltage on the low voltage side? Anyone? 345.45 is how many percentage? What is the percentage? It's again 90.9%. So can we now visualize it in a different way, which you never thought of when you have learned transformers in many other modules? They never thought or never told you about this, that actually what happens, whatever percentage of voltage you apply on any side of the transformer, you get the same percentage on the other side. And you see, you have applied 90.9% and you got 90.9% on the other side. And you see that it was never thought in that way. So what happened there? Whatever voltage, if we applied, let's say, half of that 6.6 kV, meaning 3300, we will get half of 380, which will be 190. Meaning we apply 50% of the rated voltage on the high voltage side, we will get 50% of the rated voltage on the low voltage side. So actually what happened in transformation, because when we use transformer, what we do, step down the voltage or step up the voltage. For example, on these two voltage levels here, it's a step down transformer. We apply high voltage here, we're getting low voltage. It's a transformation, stepping down or stepping up. But if we look at this way, that I applied 90.9%, I'm getting 90.9%. Where is that stepping up or stepping down? There is no stepping up, there is no stepping down. Meaning the voltage remains same in terms of percentage. If we consider the percentage, the voltage remains same. So it makes our calculation, our thinking easier. So if we now understand that, so what will happen if we say that the voltage remains same? The same thing will happen to the current. If we have a 10% current here on the high voltage side, we'll have the 10% current in the low voltage side. If we consider the resistance value on the high voltage side, when it goes to the low voltage side, you use a formula in other modules, that if you have R1 is so many ohm, R2 is equal to so many ohm, you want to find out the equivalent resistance, meaning the total. So in terms of either the primary or the secondary, so if it's in terms of primary, so you keep the R1 as R1 and then you convert that R2, multiply it by the ratio squared. You know, N2 over N1 squared or N1 over N2 squared, like that. Remember that. That you transfer all the resistances to one side, either to primary or secondary, all the inductances to either primary or secondary, or even the impedance Z1, Z2, you can transfer it to either side, primary or secondary. What you do, you keep one constant because you're transferring it to that side, and the other one is to be multiplied by either N1 over N2 whole square or N2 over N1 whole square. But if we think in terms of percentage, there will be no change. They are same all the way. It doesn't change from one side to the other of the transformer. So in a transformer, the general scenario is that voltage changes from one side to the other, current changes from one side to the other, resistance, reactance, impedance changes from one side to the other, but in terms of percentage, it doesn't change. So whenever we have transformer by a single phase or a three phase, different connection, delta connected transformer, star connected transformer, does not matter all those percentage quantities are going to remain the same. So we don't need to worry about all those calculations. All those calculations are now minimized. So that's the biggest advantage. And from there, we go to per unit. Per unit is actually, if you multiply or divide per unit and percentage quantities, we get to each other. So that's the explanation here. It's written on the slides. You will read it when you have time. But I'm coming to the advantages that are shown here on the bullet points. I'm putting the slides in front of us so that when we have understanding of this percentage quantity, that makes our calculation easier in cold calculations and other power system calculations. So when we have parameters like current, impedance, voltage, all those things, they are quantities that depend on the physical size, meaning the power rating and the voltage of the equipment. Then they have independent quantities as well. They don't depend on anything. But when it comes with our fault calculation, we consider the power unit values because they don't change from one side to the other of the transformer, or for generator they will be the same, for motor they will be the same, primary to secondary, because in motor we have rotors, stator rotor, you can consider that one as primary secondary, because for example you know that when you study three phase induction motor, actually a transformer where the secondary of the transformer is rotating, or it is actually made to rotate, whereas in transformer the secondary is not rotating, it's static. So the advantages is that if we use power unit either side of the transformer, they will give us the same value. It doesn't matter whether it's delta delta, star star, delta star. Impedance, resistance, reactance values will remain the same, and that makes our calculations easier. If we using our calculator or doing manual calculation, or if you are using computer, it reduces the computation process to a minimum value. That's the biggest advantage that we do. And for that, we need something base value. Like I was giving the example that we have a class of 69 students in this and 15 students are present. So that is the number, 69 is the base value. When I'm calculating what is the percentage of attendance today, taking 15 students attending this class, that 69 was required in the first place. If we did not have that 69, then we couldn't calculate the percentage. Similarly, when we talk about this power unit, we need the base value. Now, how we choose the base value? We normally choose the base value according to the rating of the equipment. Meaning I have a generator, so the generator has a rating, it has a KVA rating, or the transformer, it will have an MVA rating. Similarly, when we have a transformer, it also has a KVA rating. It also has a KVA rating, if it's a big transformer, MVA rating. So that KVA rating is normally chosen as the base value. Now that base value, KVA base, and that transformer or that generator or the motor will also have its rated voltage. We choose that voltage as the base voltage. So the base KVA and base voltage, they are chosen in the first place. When they are chosen in the first place, we can calculate the base current from the formula. We know that base current will be the base KVA over root 3 times base voltage. So every generator, transformer, motor that we deal with has the KVA as the voltage rating. So choose them as the base KVA. Like every class has a number of students registered, like 69 for this one, for machine maybe 62. So that 62 is the base value for that machine's two class. Right? So this is the base value concept. Whenever we want to do any percentage quantity calculation or per unit quantity calculation, we will need that base value. And that base value initially comes from that particular device or the equipment, like the motor generator transformer and so on. So we have this KVA from the motor transformer generator, this voltage, we choose them as the base one, and then we can calculate the current. And when we know the current, we can go for the calculation of base impedance, because voltage by current will be impedance. When we know the impedance, we can go for the resistance, reactance, and so on easily. Right? Now, to calculate the per unit values, there are formulas which is also very easy. Z-base that I was telling you that impedance calculation can be done from the voltage and the current. Once we know the current base, we can calculate the impedance base using the voltage base and the current base. Now, when we come to the per unit values are defined as the ratio of actual to the base. Meaning when we know the actual current and know the base current, like we can calculate the base current here, we know the base current, and any time we measure any actual value of current will be coming here. So it will give us the per unit current. Any time we measure actual voltage, the base voltage is there already, base voltage is there. Any time we measure actual voltage will come here, will give us the per unit voltage. Right? Similarly, we can have this base impedance here and take the measurement of actual impedance, put it there, and we can get the per unit impedance. So we can have the per unit values of current, voltage, and impedance of those devices or equipment in the, as the ratio of actual value to the base value. Actual value, actual current to the base current is per unit current. Actual voltage to the base voltage is actual per unit voltage. Actual impedance to the base impedance is per unit impedance. Now, if we write them in a shorter form of equation, I actual over I base, V actual over V base, and Z ohm actual over Z base. So that's the per unit. Now, to convert them to percentage is easy. If you multiply this values by 100, you go to per unit percentage. So per unit value is multiplied by 100, you get the percentage. Up until now, in the other modules, you are given percentage resistance, percentage reactance in transformer calculations. From that, you can calculate the per unit. You divide the percentage value by 100, and you get the per unit value. So you have the resistance of 5%. So the per unit is 5 over 100 is 0.05 per unit. So that is what we are going to use in our calculation. It's the same for voltage and impedance, resistance, all the quantities used to follow the same procedure. Now, sometimes when we have actual value of ohm, value of resistance, inductance or reactance, we want to convert them in per unit. Like for example, we have this actual value, we can convert them per unit like this. We use another formula as well. For example, I know the ohmic value and I know the MVA, KV, these are the base values. We can calculate the impedance per unit. Similarly, sometimes we know the per unit value, we need to convert them to actual impedance ohmic values. We can use this formula. So these two formulas are also very important that we will need in our for calculation all the time. These are very easy and simple to use. Now, when we come to choice of base value, like I mentioned that the base value is always coming from the equipment of the device. For example, a generator will have its KV rating and its KV voltage rating. And the transformer will have its own KV rating, its own voltage rating. A motor, its own KV rating, its own voltage rating. But now, when we talked about our system, they are connected to each other. Remember, from the very beginning, we are saying that our system is a system where all these equipment are connected. Now, I have a generator, I have a transformer, I have a motor. So all these devices are having their own KV rating, own voltage rating. Meaning they have their own basis for power, own base for voltage. Now, when I'm working in a system, the system is one system. I am having only one system in which all those three different equipment are there having their own basis. Now, how do I deal with that? So what I need now is a common base. For example, you are in third year. If I want to compare how much you know about electrical engineering sitting in a third year, can I compare with you in a electrical engineering student in another university? For example, in University of Pretoria or University of Tom, I cannot compare you with third year electronic engineering students because they don't know much of electrical engineering and vice versa. We need to have a common base that makes sense. And that common base can be actually completely arbitrary, like I mentioned, that I can choose either to go on University of Pretoria or Cape Town. I could also choose University of Johannesburg or in Northwest University. But it has to be on the same system. When you choose that common base, like I have a transformer, let's say 100 kVA. I have a generator, 200 kVA. I have a motor, 50 kVA. So generator, 200 kVA, I have a transformer, 100 kVA. I have a motor, 50 kVA. So what now could be the common base? It could be anything. It could be 200, it could be 500 kVA of the transformer. It could be 50 kVA of the motor. It could be none of these. I could just choose a common base of 1 kVA. It would still work if I follow the right procedure to calculate the fault current. Now I will show you that how it depends and how it changes. But when you choose the common base, we need to make sure again that our choice makes our calculation easy. So what we try to do, we try to find out in the first place if there is a base value of KVA that is common to some other devices. So for example, in this case, I said I have a transformer 100 KVA, I have a generator 200 KVA, I have a motor 50 KVA. So there is no common KVA. I can choose anyone. But if I have had a case where the generator is 200 kVA, transformer is 200 kVA, motor is 50 kVA. So in that case, I should choose 200 kVA as the base kVA. That will reduce my calculation. That will reduce the resources required for computation in digital platform. So if I find that there are common value of base kVA for different equipment, we should choose that to reduce. Not necessary to choose that, but if we choose that, it will reduce our calculation again. So in the first place, we use per unit to reduce our manual calculation and reduce the resources required for calculation in digital platform by computers in softwares. Again, we choose a base kVA that is common to more than one or two or three equipment, then it will be reducing the calculation task and resources required. Sometimes we need to consider when it is like this. For example, I was giving the example, if I compare your third year electrical engineering students with third year electronic, does not make sense. Third year electrical engineering students at UPZ and third year electrical students at UCT, it makes sense. But sometimes if I want to compare third year electrical engineering students at UPZ and third year electrical engineering students at UPZ, how does it make sense? So I could say multiply second year students by a factor 1 point something, then I could say something that would make sense. So it's the same thing when I have a generator of 200 kVA, I have a transformer of 100 kVA, I have a motor of 50 kVA, and now I'm choosing a common base kVA. So when I'm choosing that much common base kVA, I have to convert the impedances of all these three devices to that common SVA, common kVA. For example, I choose the common kVA, let's say 500 kVA. Now that is my new kVA base. At 500 kVA that I chose, because I said it could be arbitrary, so I chose it arbitrarily. That is my new base kVA. And when I have chosen that new base kVA, all the impedances of those three devices, generator, transformer, and motor, having kVA ratings of 200, 150, have to be converted to the new value. So they will have new impedance. Initially, they have their impedance that was corresponding to their kVA ratings. Now we will have to get impedances according to the new common base that the programmer or the person who is calculating the fault current is choosing. That new base kVA will give us new percentage impedance. So we'll see that in the calculations as well. When we'll do some tutorial, how to do that. It's easy. Now I'm coming to some more theoretical parts. When we have short circuits, it's a fault condition, meaning either three phases are short circuited in a three-phase system, or two phases are short circuited, or one phase is short circuited to the ground, or two phases combined together grounded. Any different short circuit conditions can happen. But we also have learned yesterday that whenever there is a short circuit, the current will rise to a very high value as compared to the rated value. And that value will depend on many things. How high that current will be, it will depend on how many generators are there in the back end. If you have more and more generators, then it will deliver more and more current. As if it's source, generators are the sources of supplying currents. So they supply currents under normal operating condition. They will also supply current under fault condition. That will, current will depend on transmission line parameters. The parameters that we calculated, like resistance, reactance, capacitance. Because if the impedance is high, it will be low. If the impedance is low, the current will be high. And then the loads that are connected. Because when we connect loads, meaning those devices, appliances that we say, kettle, geyser, or refrigerator, stove, television, laptop, all these are loads. And when you connect those loads, what actually happens? They are connected in parallel. So when you connect those loads, actually what they have inside, they have resistance, inductance in them. So they are connected in parallel, giving a rise in current during the fault condition, during the short circuit condition, will depend what is the effective value of load impedances and how they are interconnected. For example, sometimes we connect our power systems with other utilities as well. So how that is done through some transformer or a straight direct interconnection, that will also determine the short circuit level, meaning the amount of short circuit current that will flow when there will be a short circuit between two phases or in between three phases or a short circuit between a phase and the ground. So these are the main things that contribute to the short circuit currents. And when it comes with short circuit current, this is the current that we will calculate, short circuit current. And if we multiply that current by the voltage of the system, then we get the MVA level, megavolt ampere level, during that short circuit current. So it's coming from short circuit current, so it's called short circuit MVA. Short circuit current can also be calculated from the formula, which is the base current over the power unit impedance that we use in our calculation. So we can calculate the short circuit current from base current. Base current will come from the base MVA over base voltage, and from the power unit we can calculate the short circuit current. As this short circuit current related to short circuit, the MVA that we calculate here, root 3 times the short system voltage times the short circuit current, we call it short circuit MVA, which can also be calculated by this base MVA or base KVA that we choose over the power unit impedance. So these are the formula that we will need a lot during our fault calculation for all different types of faults. Now, the most important thing that we need to take note of here, these short circuit levels, meaning the either the short circuit current or short circuit MVA, they are same, actually they are proportional. If the short circuit current is high, the short circuit MVA level will also be high. So the short circuit current or short circuit MVA levels are the greatest near up to the generating station, meaning where we have generators, the short circuit levels are the highest. So how we get that one? We want to see that from that example. For example, I have a generating station here. We have two generators. So generator one, generator two. And these are the power unit impedances of the two generators, reactances of the two generators, 1.176, 1.176 power unit of two generators. And then these are the reactances of the generator. Sorry, these are the voltages of the generator. These are the reactances. And then we have a transformer to step up the voltage. And it goes to the transmission line. The transmission line is having a reactance of 0.081, and then another transformer stepping down the voltage. Its reactance is this. Then we have some load, RL load. So from this system, we can now consider how the short circuit level will vary. For example, if I imagine that at this point, F1, F1 is happening, so what will happen? The power system now is considered here in this circle. This part is isolated because when a fault occurs there, the current from the generator will come to this transformer, going through the transmission line and transformer going back to the generator neutral. So that's how the current will flow. It will not go to the load. This load is going to be out of calculation, out of the part of this power system shown in this inside the circle. So if a fault occurs at F1, all the parts in this circle will be participating in the fault calculation. Now what we see here, this reactance and resistance are out of calculation. Only these reactances will be part of this fault current calculation. So they will be determined by this. These are three reactances connected in series. A combination will be connected in parallel with of these two, and then we can determine the fault current. Now, if we consider now the fault point is moved to here, not there, then what happens? This is out. So we have less reactance because this was in series. So we excluded this one. Now we have less reactance in series. Again, these two combinations will be done series, and then these two are in parallel, combined, then use the voltage and reactance to calculate the fault current. So current is now going to be high because the impedance is less. Again, if we consider the fault is coming here, not there, this reactance is excluded. So the current will be even higher. As we reaching the generator, if we reach here, the current is going to be even higher. So as we reach the generating station, the short circuit currents on the short circuit levels are higher and higher. In opposite way, we can say that when we go away from the generator, the fault currents will be lower and lower because the impedances will be higher and higher. Is that clear? Okay, thank you. So, as we see that when you reach closer to the generator or generating station, the fault currents are becoming high and high. So what we do, we use some fault current limiting reactors to limit the fault currents, because if a fault occurs nearer to the generator, the fault currents will be very high, and because of that, the generators will get damaged. So we have to limit the fault current by the use of series reactors. We call them series reactors or current limiting reactors. So we put them in lines, we put them in bus bars, meaning we can put them here in the line and put them in the bus bar. This is a bus bar, this is a bus bar, this is another bus bar, this is load bus bar, this is the generator bus bar. So we can put them in series with the generator to increase the reactance, because if we put them in series, they will be added straight away. So that's why we call them series reactors. And we put them in the lines and we put them in the bus bars. And if we have old generators and if we have new generators, we need to consider that. In old generators, the reactance values were high. Old means I mean very old, 100 years old or 50 years old. But those generators, most of them are not operating, but some of them are still operating in old power stations, 40, 50 years old. But the modern generators are not having high reactance values. So for them, we need to pay some special attention when we do the design of them. So with those fault currents, what can happen? It can damage the lines and the equipment itself, meaning the generator itself or the transformer or the motor will be damaged, and the lines that are supplying power to them will get damaged. So to protect them, we use reactances in series with generator, transformers, lines, and sometimes other components. So these are the things that we use to protect using the series connected reactor. We call them current limiting reactor. It's explained here, so you'll read them later on. Let me show you the diagram. Yes. So when you have a power station, for example, we have three generators and we connect reactors in series with each generator. So if a fault occurs here, the current will be high, but it will still be limited by these reactors. We have added series reactors. But the problem is the voltage will go very low because of voltage drop across these reactors. That's a problem. But the advantage is that we reduce the fault current and hence we protect the generator when there is a fault in the generator bus bar. So that there are advantages and disadvantages. Sometimes we don't do that because if we add reactor in the generator, the voltage will go low because of voltage drop there. So sometimes we add the reactor in the feeders, in the lines. I mentioned that we add them in series with the generator in the lines, meaning this is a feeder, this is a line. So in series with the line, we add the reactor. So they will limit the current. So in that case, there is no voltage drop happening here in between the generator and the generator bus bar. And the voltage drop will happen here. So if a fault occurs here, the current will be limited by this reactor. So that's why they are called feeder reactor. They are connected in series with the feeder and they limit the fault currents. Now, after that, we have bus bar reactor. We connect them in the bus bars. And let me show you the diagram so you can see the bus bars. So, for example, there are three generators in this power station that diagram is showing. And each generator has its own bus bar. So this generator G1 has its own bus bar, G2 has its own bus bar, G3 has its own bus bar. Now these three generators are connected to common bus bar, right? To a reactor. So generator 1 is connected to generator 2 via a reactor. Generator 2 is connected to generator 3 via a reactor. And then generator 3 is connected to generator 1 via another reactor. And it's forming a ring. It's a closed loop. It's a ring that is formed by the use of those reactors connecting the generator from each one to the other. So that's why we call this ring main system. So when we use reactors to connect bus bars of the generator, it forms a ring main system. Call it a ring main system. It does not necessarily need to be the generator. It can be substations as well. We might have four transformers coming from four feeder lines from four different transmission lines, and then we can connect them in a ring main system from where we can supply loads. Now the advantages of this ring main is that I can connect feeder from any of these three feeders, any of these three bus bars, and load can be supplied from any of these generators. For example, if I have a fault here on this feeder, on this bus bar, we can still supply the current from the other two generators. So that's the advantage of ring main system. But if we have another configuration of ring main system, like I said, we can have four different transmission lines coming to a substation, and then we have the bus bars at the substation, we can join them like that to form a ring as well. So these are the reactors connecting the bus bars to form a ring main system. It has advantages of supplying the load at any condition when there is a fault in one of the feeders and we cannot use that line. For example, there is a fault here on this line, we can disconnect this and we still can supply this feeder using either of these three generators, and they can supply this feeder on this generator bus bar. So that's the advantage of ring main system. But if we want to use another system, we call it tie bar system. Generator bus bars are there in this is for each of them, and there is a tie bus, meaning this bus is going to tie all the generators in this system. So we connect that main bus bar of the generator using a bus bar reactor to the tie bus. Now the configuration is different here. It's no longer a ring, no longer can be called a ring main system, because it's not forming a ring. It's called tie bus system. It has some advantages in terms of protection. So let us check what are the advantages and protection on that one. So let's consider this ring main system here. So let's consider that a fault occurs here on this feeder. So what will happen? Current from this generator will be supplied to this fault point. All the generator will be supplying to this fault point because the fault is happening. So that's how this current flow is going to happen from the generator 1. From the generator 2, it is coming from there and it will go through this reactor, right? So it is going to go through this reactor. Now, because of presence of this reactor, the current will be limited or reduced because of the reactance value present in the reactor. also it will come from the generator 3, so it will come and flow through this way and go to this fault point. It won't go through this one because it is going to go through 3-2 reactances. The current will be much lower, so it will take the short circuit path, low resistance or low reactance path. So it will go through this one and that one. So what is going to happen, the current value here is also going to be reduced because of presence of this reactor, and that one is going to be direct. So advantage in terms of protection, in terms of limiting the fault current, is also coming from the SGMN system, apart from the advantage that we can supply any load by any of the three generators or any of the generators in the SGMN system. But if we have a tri-bus system, if we consider that we have a fault on the first generator of the first generator, what is going to happen? Again, this generator is going to supply this fault current directly, no reactance present. Then we'll find that second generator is coming in the picture to supply the fault current. It is going to go through this reactor, and then it has to go through this. There is no other way. It has to go through this reactor to reach the fault point. And if we look at the third one, it's the same. It's going to participate in the fault current condition, going to the reactor of its own, connecting to the tie bus, going to the tie bus. We'll have to go through this one to reach the fault point. So what's happening here? The first generator, which is closest to the fault point, is going to supply the fault current directly. No protection that much. But for the other two, is reduced because it's the fault current is flowing through two reactors in each case. In case of bypass, generator 2 and generator 3, the fault current will be flowing through two reactors, this one and that one, this one and that one. So in these cases, in this case, for these two generators, they will be supplying less fault current, meaning they will be subjected to less damage. Whereas if we go to the ringman system, each of them are supplying to the fault current through one reactor. Can you see this one is supplying to one reactor? This one is also going to supply to one reactor. Don't supply through this one because it's higher resistance than this path. This path has the least resistance. So when we have a tri-bus system, the generators are much more protected. That's why we choose tri-bus system as well in our protection system. So these are the things that I wanted to show you. Other descriptions are there in the slides, so you should read about those things. We will do tutorial from next week after the test. And for the test, I should keep it up to this theory part of this chapter and the transmission line parameters. Is that okay? Yeah, thank you very much. Anyone else happy with that? Happy with the syllabus of Monday 10:30, isn't it, the test? What I should repeat? Dunge, what must I repeat? Test scope, okay. Test time is Monday at 10:30. Right? Or 1 hour 2 minutes. Test scope, transmission line parameters, theory and tutorial. And